Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Most loving God, welcome all to our worship this morning as we come to the 13th Sunday after Trinity. And it's lovely today that we'll have the introduction of singing today as well, but I'm afraid not by ourselves, not by the congregation, not allowed to just yet. But it's lovely that we've got some singers who will be leading a responsorial psalm just after our first reading, and then we'll be going through some things for us during the offertory. Also next week, we start also, they're going to be start reintroducing as well. Robert will be playing some pieces just straight after the end of the service for about 20 minutes. You don't have to stay 20 minutes. If you've had enough after 10 minutes, you can go. But the point is, if we start playing some more voluntaries at the end of the service, anybody who wishes to listen to them, all we ask is that you stay in your places. And then when you've had enough, then you can go. But no moving about after the service. But again, we thank our singers this morning and Robert for the introduction of a bit more music to our worship. And so let us begin with just a moment's silence where we remind ourselves we're coming into the presence of God, where we ourselves become the body of Christ and we worship and touch heavenly things. So in a moment's silence, we pray. Preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires are known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
A lamb for each household.
too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbour in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over the fire, with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain till the morning. Anything that remains until the morning, you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. For the word of the Lord.
Chapter 13, beginning at verse 8.
owe no one anything, except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armour of light. Let us live honourably as in the day, not in revelling and drunkenness, but in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarrelling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Speak in the name of the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
With the school starting back this week just gone, there was a young lad called David. He was going back to middle school for his second year there. So his mum took him to the gates, masked him up with a Star Wars face mask that they've got off the internet. And off he went into school for his first day. Later on that day, his mum arrived back at the school to pick him up. And he met his mum at the school gates, full of excitement and enthusiasm from his first day back. However, he was not wearing the Star Wars face mask the morning, but now wearing a different mask with Formula One cars on. His mum asked, "What's happened to the Star Wars mask?" And David's reply was, "Well, then I traded it with my friend Darren, and Darren went on and traded another one with his friend." Children don't understand restriction too well, and neither do us adults, really. Moses and Aaron are told by the Lord about the Passover, which is to come soon to them. Part of the instruction states that if a family is too small for a whole lamb, they should join together with another family and share it. And Moses and Aaron aren't even instructed to put a risk assessment together on this either. Though the instructions God gives leading up to the Passover appears to be instructions of bringing people together. Would this also bring a brutal attack on the firstborns of Israel, of Egypt, sorry? The community of Israel are under the protection of God, while the community of Egypt is to be punished and to suffer. The question is here, is this an act of love or an act of punishment, or both? Which one of the two is more contagious also? Love and to reward, or hate and to punish? Paul tells the Romans in his letter that we should owe nothing to anyone but love. Paul lists some of the Ten Commandments given from Exodus, following that statement, that we should only owe each other love. The Ten Commandments can be also for us a set of what we might see as restrictions. They are to restrict us from committing sin. Paul, though, builds up the commandment of loving yourself and to love your neighbour. Jesus himself, long before Paul, teaches us that the two most important commandments are those to love ourselves and to love our neighbour. And Paul is pleading to the Romans, though, to avoid all the acts they do, to tear them away from love. These many years later, from Paul's epistle to the Romans, I wonder if we have made love priority on the earth now. Perhaps we really try to, but may not always succeed. Jesus goes through a structure in the gospel of how we might be able to get over sin and seek forgiveness from those who we offend. It can seem like a lengthy process if you do not get the forgiveness from the first point. More and more people get added into the process as someone seeks forgiveness for a sin committed. There is no restriction to adding people in here again. Through Jesus' process of having our sins heard and forgiven. And this is because sin is not something which is contagious. You can't catch it off someone. Because we all have it. Every single one of us in this church now, or on Zoom, Zoomers have it as well. There is no social distancing needed when it comes to sin. But love, though, can be contagious. We can pass that on to each other quite easily. Love, though, being contagious, acts as the cure for the sin we all have. Though we have our restrictions at the moment in church to protect each other, we should not mask our love towards each other up. The Gospel and the Epistle hold the fact that it isn't always easy for us to forgive, hence why Jesus provides a way of helping us to do it. That is by getting more involved, surely through one of those love and forgiveness much latch on to a sinner, giving them grace that they are forgiven for their transgressions. It becomes more like teamwork, the teamwork of the church, looking for who cries out for love. Even so, if the people or the church cannot forgive or love someone, then that person should become like a Gentile or a tax collector, bottom of the pile of sinners, with no hope in a sense. But this is nowhere the mystery of God's love shows. It's the fact that Jesus was the one who ate and drank with the tax collectors and the Gentiles. So perhaps we're possibly all in that category. This Eucharistic meal we share this morning, though restricted, is not restricted from love, but can put our sin at bay. For the Eucharist is not a feast for the virtuous, but food for the sinner. So let us not restrict our love or ability to forgive and be aware of our own failings, but that others suffer with it too. And like the young lad David and his friends, we too don't understand how to fully protect ourselves or each other from sin. We do, though, through the teachings of Christ, know how we can best help ourselves and help others overcome it. might just take two people together to conquer a sin. It might take 100 people together. Regardless, for Jesus says, for where two or three are gathered in his name, Jesus is there among them. Amen.
We stand to profess our living faith. We believe in one God, who live their lives in fear because of their faith.
Help us to listen to each other, to open-mind our hearts without restriction, and to understand and learn from each other. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, your servant Paul says, let us then lay aside works of darkness and put on the armour of light. We pray for those who are in darkness in our world, for those less fortunate than ourselves. We pray for those who are victims of war, poverty, crime, and natural disaster. We pray particularly today for the people of Birmingham, for the victims, their families and friends, and all who were affected by the atrocities last night. Give to all who suffer courage and strength in their time of need, that they may begin to see the light of hope in their lives. And we pray for all those who provide aid and support to others around the world. Lord, in your mercy. Lord Jesus said, for where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there with them. We pray for those preparing for the sacraments of baptism, marriage, and confirmation, that they may feel your presence surround them at this special time. We pray particularly for all those about to be ordained, and especially for Tom and his ministry here. We pray that their faith may shine as a light in the lives of all those whom they meet, as they share your word and your love. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, you said to Moses and Aaron, when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you. We pray for all those needing your care and protection at this time, suffering in body, mind, and spirit, especially for all affected by coronavirus. We pray for those who have asked for our prayers, for those known to ourselves, and we pray particularly for Robert Smith, Mary Birdwistle, Tessa Selby, Steve Loden, Richard Shepherd, Jenny Lowwater, Norma Johnson, Carol Ditchfield, Alex Smith, Isabel Paul, Barry Lowry, Val Carlin, Wyndham Rogers Coleman, and John Waitman. Send your Holy Spirit to comfort them at this time, that they may endure and be free from pain and distress. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, remember all those who have departed this life. We pray for the souls of Margaret Stewart, Norma Stitt, John Watchford, Alistair Sell, Diana Mudder, Father Brian Cook, Father Philip Cunningham, Howard Fagan, and Harry Buckle, who have died recently. And for the souls of Joy Richter, Alice Sayer, and Philippa Catherine, whose year's mind occurs at this time. Pray for all those who mourn, and ask that you send your Holy Spirit to comfort them in their grief. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, your Son told the disciples that the greatest commandment was to love our neighbours as ourselves. We pray that as we come to terms with a new way of living, we remember this commandment amidst anger, frustration, fear, and confusion. Help us to remember that love is patient, kind, that love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Lord, may we always know that love never ends, and that your love for us is unconditional and everlasting. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
We stand for the peace. As we come to the peace, we just reflect upon those areas in our life where we wish God's peace to dwell. We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we are all baptized into one body. Together we share the love and the presence of God our Father. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, From sunrise to sunset, this day is holy. For Christ has risen from the tomb and scattered the darkness of death with a light that will not fade. The day's day, the risen Lord walks with his gathered people and folds for us your word and makes himself known in the breaking of the bread. And though the night will overtake this day, you summon us to live in endless light, the never-ceasing Sabbath of the Lord. And so, with choirs of angels and with all the heavenly host, we proclaim your glory and join their unending song of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God, our light, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed. You are the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these your gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Christ is the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive.
His perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of our Blessed Lady and of all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, for ever and ever.
Amen.
As our Saviour taught us, so we pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
to share in the body of Christ. God's holy gifts for God's holy people.
Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. For the glory of God the Father.
Amen. This is my prayer, that you may have life, and have life in all its fullness. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, through whom we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be amongst you, and remain with you always.